Good morning. Morning. Let me go and play my Munga Honorable till them come in. Good morning. Morning. Hey, Senovia. Oh, this is coffee. Okay. Whatever. Perfect song. I hope I can hear the music. Hi, hi everybody, hello. Wow, I did it. In the meantime, Facebook, we have Instagram live for the first time. Go and listen to the music. Share up, share up, share up. And that's for the people on Facebook. Go and share up. Morning, Cynthia. Morning, everybody. Everybody on Instagram Live. Everybody on Facebook Live. Share it up for me in the meantime. Facebook Live till we start. Running a little late. You see my hand? Care problems. May I get radiator burn? Keep sharing in the meantime. Try to use the sticker. All right. All right, I think we can start now. I'll just mute the music. All right, how everybody doing? All right, so for the first time, I managed to sync Facebook Live with Instagram Live. So we have two audiences. Yay, me. Yay, 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 yay. So welcome to another edition of Monday Morning Meds. And today we are going to talk about dengue. Right, everybody? All right. So a little later on in the program, we're going to be joined by Dr. Petra Hines. And Petra did a video that is now viral, telling you she's a doctor that was Cuban trained. She's from St. Mary, and she has been seeing dengue like crazy down there. She's seen a whole heap of dengue. So we're going to be joined by her at around 8:30. A whole heap of, I'm supposed to share a screen and show on a video and thing, but I still not figure out the... I still haven't... Oh, thank you, Rex Area, on Instagram Live is saying she loves my program. Thank you very much. But Petra, I put up a picture on my page, on my Facebook page. I don't think it's on my Instagram page, where Petra was seeing at least 10 dengue cases per day. She even had a chikungunya positive test. But this goes against what the government has been saying. The government has been saying that they have seen what they were about 800 cases so far. Petra is showing that she, you know, doctors can do rapid tests in their offices. And I don't like the reflection on the glasses. When the doctors do the rapid tests in their offices, they get the results within 15 minutes. If, a matter of fact, some of these public hospitals, Senator Andrews Hospital, to do this rapid test, where you get the results in 15 minutes. Well, it's the same thing. And Petra Hines has been seeing, she put up a picture of 10 dengue positive tests in 1 week. So we want to talk about that against the background that this dengue thing are going wicked. And I know from day one my story with dengue and why I have been preaching about dengue, being that I was affected, my three kids, I nearly had two of my people, them nearly dead. I know my story already, right? Glad to say that they're all fine now. Everybody right has rained them out of the hospital. Them good, right? I am not yet emotionally recovered because it was an emotionally taxing time, but them good, them all right now. Now, in terms of what has been happening with dengue, I recently saw an epidemiology report, and it was so accidental that I got that report. It's something, a bulletin that the epidemiology, the Ministry of health epidemiology people send out every week. They have a weekly update. And you know, so this then getting up on the threshold from me, big and serious. When I see the graph, I was so shook up by it. Let me see if I can pull it up on this other phone. This is my first time using so many devices at once. I'm learning to multitask, so it's not task, so wanna see with me, right? But there is a graph that is up. I think, I don't know if I put it on my page, but in that graph, you see clearly where in May 2018, we were right on the cusp of the threshold. I think the threshold was, the threshold was 47, and we were at 41 or something like that. So we were right there. And it breaks my heart because a long time picked me a dead from dengue. You understand? Last year we had a lot of dengue deaths and we didn't even know about it. I remember on Saturday night I was at a party and I saw a friend of mine who is a drug rep. As you know, I was a drug rep for many, many years. And she has a 2-year-old. From last year he got sick and she wanted to self-medicate. She wanted to give him the Panadol, and she not the Panadol, the Cataflam. And she called one of her doctor friends. And the doctor friend said to her, don't do it because they've been seeing cases of dengue. So dengue has been going around for a while. So, you know, this, I wouldn't pop it in the dead last year, but we don't know. Even I have a friend of mine who lose her daughter. I have another friend of mine who lose his stepdaughter, if you remember, so because his stepdaughter died. We don't know. I'm not saying it's dengue killed them. But what I'm saying is a lot of children died last year from, I mean, mysteriously, under mysterious circumstances. You understand? So I opened it share up. I've been sharing up the live for me. I'm going to share it up because when Petra comes on, we want to give her a full audience, as many people as possible to ask the questions, because that is what is important. We need the questions asked. We need her to answer all of the questions for you guys. Right? Morning. Let me just go and tell my mornings from now. All right, so I've seen Carter, Boss Lady, Laura, morning there, and Simone and Dale, morning everybody. Sharon, morning. I'm happy that I can bring it on two platforms today simultaneously. May I try a thing, you know? But I'm still looking for the graph to show you. So, up to Friday, we heard that there was a death from dengue in Portland, and Saturday, I'm hearing that there was another one on Saturday as well. A child from Kingston High, a little boy from Kingston High. I've been trying to find out his name or something to give you the information. If you could just let me know the cases, because one of the main factors that we're facing is underreporting. There seems to be a lot of underreporting of the cases of deaths, the deaths by dengue. A lot of people seem to be waiting on post-mortem. And let me tell you something. Post-mortem, yes, is necessary. But if a pitney have dengue, and you know, so the pitney have dengue, whether suspected or presumed, if the pitney end up dead from some complication of dengue, dengue have some classical complications. You know, dengue hemorrhagic fever have some classic complications. Basically bleeding, right? Brain bleed is common. Intra-abdominal bleeding, meaning bleeding inside the stomach, disseminated intravascular coagulation, and Dr. Hines will tell you more about that, but that has to do bleeding out. I spoke to one mother. I visited with one mother last week. Her daughter, Leanna Gibbs, 4 years old, died on Christmas Eve. And she described how the baby bled from every single orifice. She bled from her vagina, her bottom, her mouth, her ears, her nose, her eyes. That's a condition we call disseminated intravascular coagulation. And that is basically fatal once you start doing that. And don't get me wrong, dengue is not the only thing that causes that. But once that happens, basically, you know that the person is fatal. That I've never seen anybody who with disseminated intravascular coagulation that survived. So the graph, I don't know if you can see it or the light. This is the graph I'm talking about. Let me show you over here first. If you look, you will see, if you look at May, you will see that there was a spike in the figures by May before even just look at the readings and the threshold. The red line is the threshold. Let me show you over here. So two, right, so you can see it. If you look where the May is, just look where May is. You see that the threshold, we're right on the threshold. Let me show you again over here. You're right on the threshold at May. You understand? So from May, we're seeing the spike. Look at May and June. You're seeing the spike. You see it? Yeah. So from that time, we're having a problem with dengue. That is May last year, right? I didn't start making my own noses meet, kind of load up the thing about. Thank you, Pamela. Morning, morning, Andre. Yes, Andre is saying dengue hemorrhagic fever is basically similar to Ebola. And you know, I had dengue twice. I had dengue when I was 16 years old, when I was in fifth form in high school. And I also had dengue when I was at university, at School of Physiotherapy, there was an outbreak. And I think that the outbreak that we had at School of Physiotherapy is the one that is going around now, which is, you remember when Beanie Man sing this song and him saying, give thanks to dengue fever because he had it and he did sick, sick, sick. I think that was the time that during that outbreak, I also had dengue. And I think this is the strain that is going around now. This strain seemed to be I think they say it's type 3. They have 4 different strains of dengue, type 1 to 4. And this, they put, basically when they're doing it, they put then DNV slash 1 to 4, and they use Roman numerals. Anyway, I think this type 3 is known to be the worst type, because this one, as Andre is saying on Facebook Live, and yes, like Synovia, DIC is life-threatening. It basically, I've never seen anybody survive DIC, which is disseminated intravascular coagulation, which is the fatal complication of dengue when you have gone into dengue shock syndrome. You understand? Now, you have different complications of dengue that I want to talk to the doctor about when she comes on. Those complications include dengue hemorrhagic fever, and that, as Andre says, is basically in the same category of diseases as Ebola. That's how serious it is. And when my son had it, you know, that's what the doctor said to me. So they treat this, they treat them dengue hemorrhagic like Ebola. And right now we are seeing a very high level of dengue hemorrhagic fever in Jamaica. That is due to the fact that this strain of dengue that is going around is very, very, very bad. It's a very bad strain. All right. So another complication that my daughter had is something called febrile neutropenia, which I have personally never seen before. You understand? Hi, Chantal. No, okay, Chantal is asking about the missing baby. No, and you know, my bad. Normally before we kick off, we're talking about the topic that we're going to discuss. We normally talk about what happened during the week. And becoming so excited about this dengue thing, me kinda forget. So this week on the news, one baby gets stolen from Victoria Jubilee. Remember last week there was one stolen from Cornwall Regional? Well, that one was found. But this week, one has been stolen from Victoria Jubilee into last week. I think it was Wednesday. The baby there, them not find the baby there yet. That story, I did a video on it. That situation is sticky because I heard an update this morning. The baby still has not been found, and the father is basically preparing to sue. It's so sad because this lady lost her last pregnancy. She had a stillbirth 2 years ago. She has one older child with the same man. They seem to be in a long-standing common law union. So I just want to understand that this is not like a careless girl we have 1 million picnic, right? This is a big woman. She's 41 years old. Suzette Edwards, I think her sister is on my page. Her sister messaged me actually before the news broke, and I didn't see the message in time to put it out there. But I know her sister, her cousin, I know her cousin is a good friend of mine, Tamisha Simmons, who is a friend of mine on Facebook that I've personally met. And her sister is, her sister is on my page. But this is a big woman. She has one child and she's been trying forever to have another child. She lost her second pregnancy. I know them teeth the woman baby. I want to bring back, listen. It's just so strange because of the time it happened, everything. I'm just hoping that them can get some resolution and the hospital, it just, the whole situation just looks sticky to me. And what I'm hoping is that the hospital, the police do something about it fast. If you want the details, the video is there. When I'm done going live, I will post it in the links so you can see it on IG. I'll put it in, I think the video is in my IG stories. So for my IG audience, you can go over there and look. All right. So, and then of course, you know, Munga Honorable was in a fatal accident. He did not die, but a friend of his dear friend died, apparently. He put up his first IG post about it since then. He says that none of them were the drivers, but it was a fatal accident. A 26-year-old Canadian girl, what's her name again? Tashana Cumbermatch. She lost her life in that accident, according to Munga Honorable. Both of them were asleep in the car, and they weren't the drivers. And basically, the car crashed, and it was a. If you see the video, you will see the extent of the damages, you know. But that is just a rundown of what has happened. Me can't think of nothing else on the top of my head to tell you about anything that happened this week that is topical. Those are the most topical stories that I can think about right now, apart from the murder rate. We're going to talk about that next week, by the way. We're going to talk about crime, the fact that crime is trending down this year. It's still high because it's the first week they kind of slow, but them look like them a pick up speed now, right? So we're gonna talk about that next week. But as I said, today we are dedicating today to dengue. I want to tell you, given a joke, so the dengue video that I do about Cataflam, it's all over the place. Me go downtown and people are stopping me. Me go downtown, sat there, go pick up some things down in the market, and I'm in the market and people stopping me and asking me if it's me, because you know my trademark glasses. My son used to be very happy when I would do my videos without my glasses, and I walk on the road in my glasses, because then people don't recognize me. But now with this video, in turn celebrity, the two of them, they said them are complaining. My kids complaining because now they keep on coming. Her, them friends keep coming to them and say, I see your mother, and they not really like the hype and the excitement. But I'm happy. One thing I am very happy that the word is out, because it's very important, and that is how we're going to save lives. Me have a couple issues before me bring on Petra. Petra will talk to you about the medical side, but me want to talk to you about the social side and what dengue is doing. Now, me have a couple issues. I realize that the government is blaming, basically saying it's people, nasty environment. They keep pushing this narrative, just like with the dead babies. This government push the fact that women were getting bacterial vaginosis and basically trying to blame the mothers. I'm seeing where they're basically blaming people for them surroundings. And you know, I went around last week and I looked at all the I looked at the gullies that I traverse by on a daily basis to see this condition of the gullies. First of all, we're in the rainy season, right? And because we're in the rainy season, it rained every day. Even yesterday on Sunday, it rained. It was like sheets of rain, a whole heap of rain. And as a result of that, breeding sites are there because of the rain. And there is nothing you nor I can do about that. Because as I said in my video, leaves catch water, right? You see these little plants under the bush, them have water in the, when the plants overlap and the leaf them bend, sometimes you have the leaf them on the tree and them dry up, and they have a teaspoon of water is a breeding site for mosquitoes. Did you know that? Because the larvae are so small, right? So when you hear these people walking up and down talking about we are creating the breeding sites, that's not true. The breeding sites are created by the fact that rain is falling. All my roofs stay. If I show my house top and I don't climb and don't go on there, it stay in such a way where it have little areas that the water, a sure water settle. And I can't do anything about that because I'm not climb on top of my roof. But those are breeding sites that we cannot do anything about, right? So the focus, therefore, cannot be about just containing the mosquitoes. Yes, it can. It will work to an extent. Because, I mean, if you eradicate what you can see, it's going to work. But you will never be able to eradicate the Aedes aegypti vector in totality, ever, ever, ever. Because those eggs, what I learned when chickpea was going around, those eggs can stay in a dry condition for up to 6 months without water, without hatching. And as soon as them get wet, them hatch. So you can't really blame people. You can't really blame people for the spread of the vector itself. It's not like rat where you can control rat population. With the mosquito, the Aedes aegypti, they're becoming increasingly domesticated. And as a result, there is little you can do. So therefore, it has to be about you taking precautions on your person, meaning you wearing long sleeve clothes, you wearing mosquito repellent, you using repellent sprays in the area, you using citronella candles, you protect using making sure that your windows are enmeshed. You have to do those things to protect yourself from the mosquito bite. Because it's like when we go river the other day, I went to what if your father's name when me they going Westmoreland again. Me can't remember when we're doing the tubing down in the falls near Williamsfield. Me can't remember what name. And we're doing the tubing, the river tubing. And when we come out of the when we came off the tube, the whole of it full of mosquito bites all over. Because even river water mosquito live in. The bottom line is you can't control the environment. You understand? You can do little. There's little you can do to prevent the mosquitoes from breeding up. You can do some, especially in the rainy season. When it is dry, less mosquito. When rain fall, more mosquito. I just saw this something said from day one, right? So this blaming people for them environment. Yes, obviously the environment needs to be clean, but that is not going to prevent dengue from going around. Is self-care going to prevent dengue from going around? Self-care, that is the biggest issue, right? So let me see what Andre is saying. Andre is saying, just like how them steal is the sugary drink tax. But Andre, it was a very good suggestion. So don't say them steal it. The egg prefers to lay in black container. Not black, you know, necessarily dark containers. Not necessarily black containers, but dark containers in general. Right? That is like at the back of my house. When the washroom is off, when you go out there in the morning, you turn on the light, you go out there when it is dark, and you open the door, is a one Russian mosquito trying to come in. You understand? Because them just light the dark. So you wear light colors, you try and wear full sleeve, all of that. And the thing about it is, as the doctor will tell you when she comes on, it is about jumping as soon as you get the symptoms. Dengue does not have to be fatal. If you treat yourself correctly, go to the doctor when you're supposed to. Matter of fact, let me not say treat yourself. If you seek medical attention immediately, any little flu, there's so many things I learned from Petra video. Terrell is saying it's probably the government causing scientists to let out stuff in the atmosphere. No, let me tell you something. You see, this here mosquito here where I go around now, I swear, said this mosquito evolved. Aedes aegypti is the oldest known creature. You understand? The Aedes aegypti mosquito has been, the reason why it named aegypti is because there is evidence that that mosquito existed among the first men. And as man evolved, that mosquito evolved. Me nah ask no. You know, she said the mosquito them come in like them well domesticated. Let me tell you something. Very soon, that zapper now go kill the mosquito. I'm telling you, the zapper them now go kill the mosquito. Very soon, they'll be able to inhale that malathion spray with them use and fog the area. And nothing under them because they're so, it's like they keep evolving. So we evolve, so them evolve too. That is how I see it with that mosquito. And then I see that there is another virus that them say is in Haiti now called MADV. And that causes encephalitis that is almost like bovine encephalitis because mad cow disease. Well, the same, this one is slightly different and it is transmitted through animals, including the mosquito vector. And any of that ever spread and carry on through the Caribbean dog near supper, because encephalitis is most of the times fatal. You understand? So if we don't catch that, it's one Jamaican never here died of viral encephalitis, and she was a physiotherapist that died in 2005. She went to Ireland, got mad cow disease, bovine encephalitis, and came back here and did Elizabeth Robinson, and she was my mother's good friend. That's the only Jamaican I've ever heard that died from that. All right, so it's 8:30 now. I'm going to try and get on to Dr. Hines now. So give me a minute. God, the phone freeze. It's freeze. Okay, here we go. I'm going to try and get her on the phone. So just give me a minute. Petra. All right, let's try and call her now. Petra? All right, this your phone here, give me one, look like something wrong with the touch. This phone, I using the my second phone. She's on, guys, just give me a minute because the phone, don't move, Petra. May I try bring up back the screen? It looked like my son damaged the touch on it. The hell? Like it have shot or something. Like the touch slow. No wonder I won't use it so much again. I think him easy. Him got through these instruments like nothing. Something wrong with the touch. I can't hear you because, but you're not on speaker yet, and I want to put you on speaker. It looks like him damaged the phone. Yeah, man, him damaged it, him damaged the touch. I wonder if he won't use it. Jeez, you're afraid. Because I have an audience on the other phone, I'm using it to live stream, but it damaged. All right, I'm going to restart the phone, Petra, and then I'm going to call you back. All right, so stay by your phone. All right, restart. It looks like my son damaged this phone. All right, so just give her a minute, guys. She's ready. That's Dr. Hines. I just want to be able to get her on speaker so that she can talk to you. But yeah, we were talking about the Madagari, and Nadine is saying that there's swine flu death in Trinidad. Yeah, we have to watch that. Tara is saying is that I can add her live on Facebook. Why? Let me tell you something. I understand this Facebook Live thing too well, so I'm not going to pretend that I do in terms of adding somebody on. I tried it already and it never worked out. So let me just put her, let me just go all mean over do it, which is call her and put her on speaker, because remember, Terrell, that I also have an audience on IG Live. We have an audience on IG Live, so we want to be able to give them the opportunity to hear what Dr. Hines is saying as well. So the phone is restarting. All right. Andre is saying, I also think that we are ignoring the fact that the mosquito is just a vector. It only carries the disease. We should ensure that, yes, Andre. And I'm glad you bring that up, because when my two kids were admitted at UA Hospital on the ward, let me tell you, UA A&E was excellent. When my son was on the adult male ward, excellent service, but me never too impressed with the UA pediatric service at all. And me tell everybody that all the time. I was not impressed. All right, we're getting somewhere. I restarted the phone. I wasn't impressed. All right, yes, Petra, are you hearing me now?
Sure.
All right. Hello? Yes, I'm hearing you. I'm just putting the phone that everybody can hear you. All right, everybody. So welcome Dr. Petra Hines. And Dr. Hines is a Cuban-trained medical practitioner who is based in Port Maria. And if you don't know where Port Maria is, that is in St. Mary. Dr. Hines recently did a video about dengue, what you should expect. And that video, I get that video back from so many people now. It's everywhere. The video is being spread. It was excellent information. If you haven't seen that video as yet, you can go on my page when we're done live and you will see it. I'm sure you get that video. All right, Dr. Hines, how are you?
Thanks for having me, Mama.
You are most welcome, my darling. All right, so dengue, talk to me about dengue, because you have been from before I even spoke to before I even started talking about my kids with dengue, you've been talking about dengue.
All right, the thing about it, you know, strangely, Kamla, you're talking about dengue, I'm talking about dengue, and the public health is trying to hide dengue. Because before we even go into the symptoms of dengue, I have to tell you that we have not, the private practitioners have not received any information at all. We have not received any correspondence, we have not received any support when it comes to treating dengue patients in the private sector. And we're kind of getting a little bit of resistance now, since posting that video,
and yes,
you know, public sector trying to discourage us from doing the testing privately and saying that we should send them into National Public Health Lab for PCR.
I'm glad you brought that up. I want you to talk about that, because I remember that when that video when you did that video and that video started going viral, you also put up a picture with 10 positive dengue tests and one positive chickpea test that you did. And you did complain that you were, and that was in one day, Lord. Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I was getting a call and thing that looked like Socrates. Somebody please, whoever watching, please message Socrates and tell him don't call me right now. Somebody send him a message, because he's interrupting my life. All right, so, yeah. So
we're doing these tests, and these tests are approved, they're FDA approved, they're CE approved, they're approved by everybody. And Jamaica approves it to be used in the public labs, because these are the same tests that we use for rapid HIV, VDRL, pregnancy tests. SD Bioline is a brand that is used everywhere, a German brand, and we use it in public health.
But right.
All of a sudden, we can no longer use it for dengue rapid testing, because they want their numbers, they want a confirmation from National Public Health Lab.
But that makes no sense.
National Public Health Lab. But we know how that lab goes.
Yeah.
You send your samples there, and anybody who has done a pap smear in public sector knows
how long it takes.
Because you don't get that result until 6 months after. You have to wonder if it's your result, and sometimes they even lose the samples. So I would not be trusting numbers to come from there. And no apologies about that. So I've been doing the tests in the office, and believe me, we're getting about 10 to 15 positive tests every day.
Every day. And so that's 10 to 15 positive dengue tests per day.
In one office in Pomeria.
In one office. Are you the only doctor that is doing?
In Pomeria.
And they all do the test?
No, just me.
You are the only one. So it is safe to say that privately, and I'm sure even though you're the only one that does testing, they are still seeing dengue in their offices as well.
They're still seeing cases. And since the video came out, doctors from Oshiris have been calling me and wanting to be asking where I get the test to buy. No, these tests are widely advertised, and the mid reps have come around.
They come to my office with it. They come to my office with it.
There's no outbreak, right. And now that there's an outbreak, it's just time to pick up, because when there was chickpea, I bought chickpea tests.
Right.
When there was Zika, I bought,
you bought the Zika test.
Now there's dengue,
I bought the dengue test. Yeah, fair enough.
So as long as there's something going around, you buy what you have to buy.
Exactly.
And you make sure that your patients, you know exactly what's happening to them. I have an issue with a comment that somebody in public sector said to me, and she's one of the chief doctors there, and
right,
told me that I have to be careful how I'm spreading fear among the population.
So they don't want you talking about dengue?
No. I'm not to publish any tests. I'm not to take pictures of anything. I'm not to talk about it. I'm not to spread any fear. We're not to spread any fear.
But we are supposed to be spreading fear, because that's the only thing. It's a deadly disease. So if Ebola comes, we shouldn't spread fear either.
That's the only way to put people on alert.
Exactly.
Spreading fear. Breaking news, dengue is out there. This is what will happen to your picnic, they will dead.
Dengue alert. But every day we're hearing of dead children.
Yeah, and we're not hearing the real numbers either. I am convinced we're not hearing the real numbers.
Definitely, because every day people message me every day since I've been looking. People have been messaging me every day about kids that die. The only issue is that sometimes they can't put fire. Once they give me the picture and the name of the child, I will post it. But sometimes they give me the name and no picture, so I can't post anything. Because I like to humanize. When I talk about people, I like to humanize them. So people know that this is somebody's child. This is somebody's brother. This is somebody's... You understand? But let us start now. Dr. Hines, me could talk now about the dengue symptoms.
Okay. All right, so dengue symptoms basically are a flu-like set of symptoms.
Right.
Rapid onset of fever.
Mm-hmm.
You wake up and get a fever, you have fever at night, and then you start having your joint pains.
Everybody get the fever?
Not everybody. So you can get one or two of any series of symptoms. If you hear a noise in my background, it's a parrot. That is
oh, okay.
Yeah. So,
exactly real things.
Any combination of these symptoms. So you may have a fever.
Yeah.
Or you may just feel chills.
Mm-hmm.
You don't really, you know, people call that inside fever.
Inside fever. Right.
Right. You get these chills. You may sweat. And you just feel weak in general.
Yeah.
You may have joint pains, you may have muscle pain, so you feel
right.
Like flesh rotting, you feel like you went to the gym, and headache, of course. Like adults complaining about headache, a headache across the forehead, and it just feel like migraine sometimes, and it just feels like a heavy ache in the front
right.
of the
face. Mm-hmm.
And some people feel, they say they feel a heavy weight on top of the head, like the headache is heavy and it's on top of your head.
And the eyes, the pain behind the eyes.
The pain in the eyes, especially if you move them left to right.
Yes. Okay, so you hear that, guys? When you move, I didn't even know that because my kids didn't describe that to me. When you move the eyes left to right, the pain. Because I remember they had the pain, the eye pain, but I didn't remember. One thing also, Dr. Hines, I don't know if anybody, any of your patients tell you, but with my eldest son, when he just started getting it, he used to be a footballer, so him all injured him started acting up.
Yeah. But you find that with all the flaviviruses, this type of virus.
The flaviviruses causes all, okay.
Yellow fever, all of those, they cause your all injuries to
just like chickpea. So chickpea.
Right.
Chickpea, Zika, dengue, yellow fever. You hear that, family? All of those viruses. When you feel the old injury, them start acting up. And also a warning to sicklers, because you know sicklers always are in pain and they take.
Yes.
Yeah, they tend to take NSAIDs for the pain.
Right. And these sicklers have to be extremely cautious because they tend to have joint pain.
Right.
Because it is their regular joint pain and it's dengue this time.
Exactly.
And they tend to take Cataflam and Voltaren.
Which?
And it just.
That will kill them more than. It will kill them faster than anybody else.
Faster than anybody else, right.
Right.
The only thing that works well with sicklers is like malaria. You know, sicklers tend not to go down in malaria, but all the others get ill. Yes.
All right, we have a question for you, Dr. Hines. I bought my Panadol to begin if my family contracts dengue. When do we seek medical attention? What's the red flag for medical attention?
I think in an outbreak, medical attention should be sought whenever you feel like you have dengue. So the minute you have fever and joint pains,
go to the doctor. Go on a doctor.
Yeah.
And I've been preaching that. I did a video where I said, go on a doctor. Anything happen to you, go on a doctor. Don't wait. I nearly lost my son because I waited a little bit too long because apparently it comes. And I want you to go and talk about the complications now, because one of the complications my son had was the splenomegaly, which is the enlarged spleen. Yeah. And I didn't even know that was a complication of dengue until my son had it. And he said in belly feel like it did want burst.
Yeah, man, that's actually a typical finding in dengue. Initially, especially in children and teenagers, what happens with dengue is that it damages your platelets and your platelets cause your blood to clot.
Right.
So the spleen is there, active, the spleen and bone marrow are actively trying to push out platelets, plus the spleen is picking up all the damaged platelets, cleaning them out. And so you find that the spleen is enlarged, and this spleen is found on the left side, right up on the ribs.
Mm-hmm.
So you feel this tight balloon filling up inside.
Okay.
And it just feels like a pain. It feels like a tightness.
Tightness.
And then it increases in size so much that sometimes the person's stomach capacity is smaller and they start vomiting after every meal.
That's what happened with my son. He started vomiting after, and the spleen can burst, right? It can rupture.
It can rupture, and that's it for you.
Ah,
because it happens so often in the smaller children, you have to be especially careful with them.
You're hearing that exactly. That's why we've seen so many deaths, especially in children between 2 and 4.
In children,
Right, all right. So Nadine is asking you, when one confirmed the confirmed case, will others around that person be catching the dengue?
So the other persons around the person may catch it if they are bitten by mosquitoes that have bit the first person.
As a matter of fact, it incubates too, because with my children, while we were trying to diagnose one, the others were incubating.
Right, right. Because the incubation is 3 to 15 days, and so you expect 3 to 15 days after the first person gets it, then the other person may just show signs. So while you're using the after protected, the other persons in the house, the other ones may already have it and not show signs.
Exactly. And sometimes dengue is asymptomatic as well?
Not usually. But asymptomatic, not asymptomatic, but atypical.
Atypical.
So you may not get the typical symptoms, but you get some symptoms. For example, nowadays I find a lot of people coming with joint pain, but no fever.
Right.
Aches and pains, but no fever. Headache alone, but no fever and joint pains. You know, so this is atypical. And you're going to say, okay, migraine. Okay, oh, I have a pressure. You know, and you're looking for everything else to cause a headache. But
no dengue.
And it's positive.
And you know, it happened to one of the, it happened to, I want to give you the joke, it happened to the cataflam rep in my office the other day. You know, I found it so, thing there, but she ended
the
up.
The right person for it to happen.
Well, you know. Yeah. Cause she, but the thing is, you know, she's human too. She's my friend, but it's right. Just that this dengue is going around now. So they understand that right now, cataflam is, and we need to talk about that, the contraindicated drugs and why they are contraindicated.
Mm-hmm. All right, so we do not use NSAIDs nor steroids. I find that a lot of persons don't know about the contraindicated steroid use, because we don't use NSAIDs, but we know Advil,
right,
Motrin, the mm-hmm. cataflam, the aspirin, Piroxicam, we don't use any of those. Meloxicam, we don't use any of those.
So meloxicam, so all of these drugs that you don't know about, meloxicam, piroxicam.
No painkiller.
No painkiller.
No painkiller.
But but cetamol.
Panadol mm-hmm. and Baralgin.
Baralgin is safe.
Cetamol, yeah, Baralgin is safe.
All right.
Because for people with very, very bad headaches, I give them Baralgin and Panadol together.
Okay.
It tends to help better than just one.
I understand.
Codeine is also safe.
Codeine is safe.
Safe. Yes.
All right. So the safest thing to do. Mm-hmm. So the safest thing to do, listeners, this morning is to write down what you can use, because the list of what you can't use is so much, so long. So mm-hmm. as Dr. Hines says, Panadol, Cetamol, Panadine, Baralgin. Right?
That's it.
That's it. Nothing else. Nothing else. And Cetadine, because I know Cetadine have a codeine thing.
Right.
Nothing else. And for my listeners overseas, Tylenol is the same as Panadol.
Right.
Right.
The other thing that's contraindicated are steroids.
Steroids.
So you have to be careful of the children who get asthma.
Asthma attacks. Oh,
yes,
wow.
Because they will be getting prednisone.
So, I'm glad. Stick up in right there, Doc. I'm glad you mentioned that, because that when a child is describing pain, when them, especially an asthmatic child, that chest tightness, that this splenomegaly can be mistaken by the parent for the chest tightness from asthma.
Right, right.
And normally,
chest pain.
Right.
All of the front of the body to them is chest.
Exactly.
So you're gonna say, I have chest pain.
Them call it stomach.
Them.
And we normally give them we normally give them preventative inhalers, and now you're saying those are also contraindicated during dengue.
The steroid
one, that's the Becotide, the brown one.
Becotide and Seretide, which is purple.
Seretide, so the purple inhaler and the brown inhaler for all you asthmatics.
Right.
Contraindicated. And prednisone, the little white pill them. The little pink pills.
The bitter
pill them.
Bitter
right.
You know them.
Yes, I know them. My son is asthmatic. So and right. So listen carefully, because this is
asthma season anyway.
It's asthma season. Exactly. Yes, Karine is saying if paracetamol mixed with codeine is okay. Yes, definitely.
That's fine, yeah.
That is fine. All right. So Doc, Talk to me now. We were talking before about the spread of dengue. I know I have other things to ask you about that. I put out a graph recently. We've been hearing of children dying, basically without any cause. We don't know why. Then just a drop dead. From up early in last year, I don't know if you are aware, but there have been many cases of children just dying mysteriously. I'm not saying it is, but based on the numbers that you are seeing, you think the dengue could have been killing kids from as early as March?
Definitely. And if you look at the graph that you send around, you realize that the alert level was from about May.
Yes, I was
Yeah,
talking about that
there was
before.
some problem there.
Right, so the
So
levels have been high.
the alerts have been sent out from early last year.
From early last year. And
Early last
as
year.
we've been hearing, CARPA, that's the Caribbean Public Health Association, they said they put out from May last year that we were going to have an issue with dengue.
Right. Well, dengue is now endemic to Jamaica.
Right. And explain what that means. Explain what endemic means.
So endemic means it's always here. It's basically always here. I don't particularly believe that because, no, I'm not sure if dengue always been here.
Okay.
We don't always have flu-like symptoms whenever there's a particular flu season in Jamaica,
Yes.
and the flu is flu. And it's
Yes.
normally the respiratory flu that leaves with a dry cough.
Definitely.
I don't know about dengue always being here. We have outbreaks. It's not endemic yet. And well, they have done their studies, so they may have their numbers, but I really have not been seeing dengue cases all year. You know, not
Okay.
endemic. I don't think so.
Okay, so it's not, but even though the ministry claims it is endemic, because the thing is, when I started talking about dengue in November when my kids had it, that's the first thing these people came and tell me. I'm over by Twitter that dengue is endemic, so there are always cases. They're sorry that my children have it, but it's no big deal. That's when I just started making noise about it, and I'm saying, but my kids were at the hospital, and they were not the only ones at the hospital with it. I mean, it's
Right, and if
everywhere.
you're not testing for dengue, how do you know that it's always here? If
Exactly.
you're not testing for it, you know, how do you know it's here? You know, I'm not really
Buying that.
I'm not into that. No, I'm not buying that.
All right. So we have a question here from Donna Everbless. I think you discussed that already. How can I protect my children from dengue? I'll be traveling to Jamaica from UK next month. Please advise.
Okay, so you're coming from UK, travel with your off, your insect repellent, travel with your citronella cans and lotions and sprays. But remember that dengue must Aedes aegypti that transmit dengue are day biting mosquitoes.
Yes,
Dusk
dusk
to
in the
dawn,
evenings,
sorry,
5 to 7,
dusk
five to
to
seven in the
evening,
evenings, and
evening
in the
to the
morning.
morning again, right. So they are day biting mosquitoes. So you find that you'll have to protect your children in the daytime, early mornings, and late in the night also. So basically 24 hours have to protect yourself. So travel with your off, travel with your citronella candles, your organic, insect repellents and stuff like that. For the children who are allergic to off, because off can be a little bit abrasive on the skin,
Right.
there are some organic versions out there that you can use. There's a Jamaican brand that makes an organic version. And then there are citronella sprays and lemongrass and citronella things too that can repel insects. For small babies, don't for small babies, don't spray off on the babies. You're going to use a mosquito armband, but don't put
Okay.
it on the baby's arm, put it on the baby's ankles.
Ankles.
And then with the babies who don't actually suck their toes because they have some very flexible babies,
Yes.
especially if they're asleep, slip it over their ankles and leave it there for them to sleep with under a mosquito net. That's for small babies. Or it's a very tiny baby that doesn't grasp, don't touch things, then put it on the pillow beside them. The little
For the
coily
very
armband,
newborn baby.
coily arm, right. And there are some other products. I think the line is called Pigeon. Pigeon
Okay.
baby products, but they have some baby insect repellents too. So you have to do your research and look
Yeah.
into stuff.
And as Andre is saying, bed nets, just buy out the bed net them. Sometimes it's uncomfortable to sleep under, but dengue is much more uncomfortable. I can guarantee you that. All right,
You
so
have kids at school, send a can off for the teacher.
definitely. And I saw you giving that advice to a friend of mine on my page that send it the off to the teacher so that the children the
mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I see my son's school doing that.
Sends a can. Yeah, if every parent sends a can, the teacher will have enough to spray the children's legs when they're going inside the classroom.
Definitely, especially at more than one time too. All right, so we have a question here from Tyrell. My mom came up from Jamaica a week now, and since then I've been having a splitting headache, like my head is gonna burst and I feel dizzy. Every time I get up, my skin itching more than usual. I don't have any appetite. Are these symptoms of dengue?
They can be. You have to get tested, yes.
So you get tested, all right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I don't see any more questions.
Guess what? An older person who has dengue may just mistake it for arthritis.
You know? Exactly.
Say they have dengue.
Exactly.
So, you know, she could have something.
She could have had dengue and not realize that it's dengue. You know, because when my parents who are now senior citizens get these mosquito viruses, they hardly get the fever, they get the aches and the pains. But no, if my mother wasn't tested for chickpea, she would not have known she has chickpea because she has rheumatoid arthritis. So the pain is there anyway, you understand? So definitely, I'm trying to think off the top of my head what else we need to ask you about. Yes, we were talking about the complications. We know about, all right, tell me about, yes, we need to talk about the complications now, the dengue shock syndrome, the dengue hemorrhagic fever, and one that people don't know about, but which I experienced firsthand, febrile neutropenia.
Okay, what we'll find is that a lot of the dengue patients get a fever and their white blood cell count falls.
Mm-hmm.
And they call that neutropenia.
Right.
Or leukopenia. So the white blood cell count falls. And of course, you know, the white cells are responsible for our defense
right.
and our immunity.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, you're putting yourself in an immunocompromised state where your immunity is compromised, your immunity is low.
Like you have cancer or AIDS or something like that.
HIV, right. Mm-hmm. Which is way down. And apart from the white cell being depleted, you have the platelets being broken. So you risk anything infectious afterwards, and you risk anything bleeding afterwards. So the complications are usually infectious or bleeding, but usually bleeding complications. What a lot of persons don't understand is that dengue hemorrhagic fever is not a complication of dengue. Dengue hemorrhagic fever is a variant. A child might just get dengue and just get dengue hemorrhagic fever same time.
Okay.
You have to go from dengue to dengue hemorrhagic fever. It's not a complication. It's actually a different variant because the dengue virus has four serotypes.
So this variant that is going around now, obviously, is the one that causes hemorrhagic fever.
Hemorrhagic fever, right. So this variant, well, obviously more than one variant are going around because people are not getting regular dengue, but the kids are getting the hemorrhagic fever.
My kids had it.
Right, they're getting it right away. They're not getting the dengue first and then get complicated. They're just getting the hemorrhagic fever right away. So if you see your child with a fever and you see your child feeling weak, get to the doctor. Because and ask that you do a blood count. Do a CBC.
The complete blood count.
Do a CBC, yes, because by the time they feel sick and start to look weak, at least the white cell and the platelets would have been moving down for you to say, okay, doctor, I want child to stay in hospital. I want to watch this. I want this child to be watched.
And you know, I thought that the dengue hemorrhagic fever was actually a complication. I didn't actually know that it was actually one of the strains of the dengue that causes it.
One of the variant illnesses. Yeah. So you can get it right away.
Wow.
There's no waiting time for that.
There's no waiting time. And okay. So what about dengue shock syndrome?
So the shock syndrome, it basically is like what your child was going to get.
Right.
Where the spleen was sucking up all the platelets, damaged platelets, and giving him hypovolemia, because when the spleen sucks up these platelets, it sucks up a portion of your blood.
Right.
And so you find that this person is acting as if a person is losing blood. You know,
I hear that.
Where are you losing this blood? Your blood count going down, the person getting cold, the person starts sweat profusely.
Yes.
Where is this person losing blood? To the spleen itself.
So the spleen, you know, that's why the spleen is swelling, because the spleen is filling up with the blood.
Sequestering all the blood. And the same thing that happened in sequestered patients, where the spleen sucks up the blood and they go in hypovolemic shock. So you lose the blood arm volume, but inside the spleen. You know, so it's a wicked complication. It's a bad complication, very critical to a patient. So if the person is in hospital, then they have the options of treatment, there's treatment. You know, you have splenectomy, if it's very, very critical, and then you replace the blood volume.
Right.
Because of course, you know, we don't need the spleen
100%. Exactly.
So we can't do without. So there's a splenectomy, but this has to happen in a very small window of time.
Definitely. So you have to move.
Needs to be in hospital.
You
need to move right away with the child.
You know, I found that IV fluids.
Go to private doctor.
Right.
Go hospital.
Go hospital. Okay, you hear that? So repeat that for me again, Dr. Hines.
If you hear about belly pain, the child, especially children we're talking about, adults with no heart bodies, but if a child has belly pain and they have the fever and they get symptoms, emergency room.
Emergent. That's, I think that's what saved my son's life. I went straight to the emergency room. But what I was about to ask you again, we need to talk about blood now, because there has to be a blood drive, because I don't think people understand why dengue patients need blood. Explain to them why dengue patients need blood.
Okay, so because the dengue virus actually destroys the platelets, and the platelets are what causes your blood to clot. So in the blood you have white cells, red cells, and platelets, right, as cell types. The platelets get damaged and they cause your blood to clot. If you don't have these platelets, because dengue is destroying them, what's going to happen is that you're going to have bleeding problems. You're going to bleed because you can't clot. Now, if your platelets are down, I need to give you a transfusion of platelets. And these transfusion of platelets are platelets that were taken from the blood bank, from blood samples in the blood bank. It means that we have depleted that blood supply to give patient platelets. So the blood drive is not for whole blood. The blood drive is for platelets. So we need to take the blood to separate the platelets to give to the dengue patients. And that is why we need the blood right now. I see where the Cuban embassy, all the staff from the Cuban embassy,
yes,
give blood recently. So, you know, and I'm waiting to see what other bodies in Jamaica will pick up.
Will pick up, because I noticed that the Cubans jumped right away. You know, when my son was sick, we did a blood drive. His school arranged a blood drive immediately. You know, and he got in some donations there, even though he did not end up needing that blood anymore. But I'm sure that it helped. Exactly.
Somebody needed it.
Because, right. I was about to talk about that.
It was depleted, yeah.
So you remember now that other patients out there also need blood for various, when they need surgery, all sorts of things we need blood for. And the whole blood stock is depleted. So the best thing you can do is go and donate some blood. If you can donate blood, Petra. It looks like the call dropped. Okay.
No, I'm here now.
All right. So I was just saying to them that the best thing some of us can do is go donate blood. If we can arrange some blood drives, I'm thinking of doing another one. One was done for my son already. Uh-huh. But if we can donate some blood. All right, Instagram Live. Let me just set the Instagram Live. My Instagram Live followers in another 10 seconds. Instagram only gives you 1 hour per live. So in another 10 seconds, it's going to cut out. But I'm still on Facebook. If some of you come over to Facebook, we'll continue till about 9:15, because we started late. All right.
And also, if a person knows of a patient who's in hospital, may have dengue, and you have blood donor slips,
right,
if you could give them a donor slip,
Definitely. So give them the donor slip. And I remember when my grandmother had lymphoma, and we used to have to get blood for her regularly. So we used to save up those donor slips. So a lot of people out there have people who donate blood regularly. But right now, there is definitely a shortage in the blood bank. Because when my son was sick, they were saying that there was a shortage of platelets. And with how dengue going on now, we know. So the best thing you can do is give blood. So let us go through some of the
question, though.
Uh-huh.
A question though at this point. Isn't there a way to get like the army and the members of the JSF to donate a unit of blood each?
I am wondering, and that's a very, very good suggestion. I see Chopper John West earlier on my live, making up him nice. So if Chopper John is still here, please to talk to your ministry them and see if the members of the army and the JCF can each donate, make them run blood drive, because they have to be healthy, right?
Of course.
Right. Morning, Doc. Is there any information for Doc? I don't know. Thank you, Barry. Barry is saying that the very informative program. That's what we try to do. This dengue thing, it, and that is something that upset me this week. I came under immense attack this week because people were saying I'm politicizing dengue. Let me tell you something. Whether I want to vote for PNP or JP, let me make sure so you can see my eye them good. Whether I want to vote for PNP or JP, the mosquito them I go bite or no. There is no PNP mosquito and there is no JP mosquito. One of the children that died that I visited her family is in the middle of, I'm not going to put her out there, but is in the middle of a strong JLP garrison. And let me tell you something, that child is still dead. It's a four-year-old child and she's still dead. And what upset me is there is a gully beside the house, right? And the stench that was coming from the gully, and that is the stench you get from stagnant water. That's a stagnant water stench. And that is a breeding site for mosquito. This is not a political issue, right? This is something that is affecting us overall. It is called an epidemic, right? So don't bother tell me about me politicizing it, because I am so passionate about it. It's because me nearly see my pitney bleed out with it. Because Dr. Hines, my son started to bleed. He was bleeding through his nose, right? Him tears did pink. Him did have petechiae, which is the bleeding into this. He had petechiae. His blood platelets were 18. You understand? So I saw how sick he was. So this is something that I'm very, very passionate about. We do not need to politicize this. When you see me, not the ministers, because I think that he could have alerted us as a nation from way, way before. And I understand that he personally is not a medical professional, you know, but him have medical professionals in the ministry. Right?
I understand that, but there should be advisors, there are public health inspectors, there are public health nurses, there are persons who we should be taking instruction from. My thing doing a Kamla is not like that. Not only that he should have publicized it in earlier, but also since we have declared that there's an outbreak, I have not seen any measures to stem the outbreak.
What measures would you suggest in terms of stemming the outbreak?
I don't see eradication of breeding sites going on. Mm-hmm. I don't see any report system. Like, this is where you report your cases. This is what we're going to do. The public health nurses have not been coming to the private doctors. Nothing. I don't see what we're doing.
And we see the minister in Portmore, he's doing a lot in Portmore, but there are many, many more areas. We see him because, you know, he's a very, very, him love public relations. And we see him in...
Can he help us right now? Pierre cannot help us right now. And so you know that your private doctors are seeing more cases than the hospital, because people would have chosen to go to
the private doctors.
Those are a long wait and it's inconvenient.
So definitely.
Make a special reporting mechanism, make a special hotline.
Definitely.
If you have this, this is where you get the information.
And also the reporting from the dengue rapid test, which you do, and I know that's the same rapid test that Andrews Hospital do, where them charge an arm and a leg for.
Thank you very much. Yep.
Taking those numbers. Because I wanted to talk to you about this too before you go, because I've been hearing I heard Dr. Aldor saying that it is very, very, the whole reporting, the private doctors reporting the dengue cases tend to be it very, very, the whole system tends to be cumbersome and archaic in terms of reporting your numbers as a private doctor.
This system doesn't even exist, Kamla. You have to take your own initiative to get up and drive to the hospital or the health department and give them the numbers if they want it. Nobody has ever asked, nobody has ever called, nothing at all.
But it's so simple to communicate though, because all doctors are registered with MAJ, don't?
Yes.
All doctors are registered with MAJ. So therefore, an MAJ communicates with doctors. Medical, not just MAJ, but all doctors have to be registered to practice with the medical council.
Medical council, Jamaica, right?
Exactly.
The thing about it is that if you know there's an outbreak, you deal with your hospital and clinic cases, but there needs to be a reporting sheet that is given to the private doctors, and every health department knows their private doctors in the same town.
And so it's easy to exactly. But we have email too. We can email. We can send the sheets and email it through medical council, because every doctor Medical Council has all the contact information for all doctors registered to practice in Jamaica. Whether practice public. Also does. You see? So it's so simple to do.
To send out these reporting. Yeah, right. There are no reporting systems. That's a problem. That's a big, big problem.
Wow. Wow, wow, wow. Well, I see Barry Black saying, come as long as you expose those who are responsible, there is always going to be uproar and spin about politics. What you are doing is what they should have done. Thank you, Barry. I really appreciate that. And I want people to just understand that is something that affects all of us. And the worst part about it, what really break my heart personally, is the fact that it's the children who seem to be dying mostly from dengue right now.
That's what usually happens. Infants,
it is so sad. It is so sad. Not just infants, because you have the older children dying too, and children missing.
You have even adults. Last week it was.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've seen cases where the adults are dying. Everybody dying. So, I mean, we have to come together as a people. And
but how much money is and this is politicizing now, because if I want to politicize something, I can, and I have free will to do so if I want to. No, we need to hear, number one, what amount of money is allocated for eradication strategies.
Yeah.
We need to know who gets this money and what the residents. We it's information that needs to go to the neighborhood wash groups, in the citizens groups, in the different school PTA. This information needs to go out to people who are non-medical. And since the outbreak is on the medical people handling all this information, and the medical people are not the ones getting sick.
What? So exactly. Exactly.
You know, to sensitize children, to sensitize the adults, you know, what to do. And what are the eradication methods? Because I don't see any going on. You know, we take instruction from Cuba every now and then.
Yes.
And I know that this government does not like instruction from Cuba because of a little bit of embarrassment. But one of the things that we need to do is to go out there and to see how Cuba conducts their eradication.
Definitely.
And their methods. Cuba does not respond to an outbreak because they have a dengue mosquito an army, and it's an army of people, just like the JCF and
okay, so they have a dengue, they have a mosquito army.
All the time. They wear gray uniform and they're all the time. So then Cuba doesn't really have outbreaks of these diseases.
But
and
you see,
they come to your door, they knock on your door, they check your drums for water, they check your flower pots, and they're the ones that do these things and sign a little paper on your door and move on.
I see the ministry sending out people like that. People came in to be fair to the minister, I've seen people come to my house. With this, I think it's something that started recently, but as you said, this something can be only during mosquito season. It has to be year round.
It's all year round.
It has to be year round. And you know, I think during this outbreak, I'm glad you brought up the fact that they are probably embarrassed, but what we need them to do is get, because remember, it was the Cubans who went to Africa and helped with Ebola, you know.
Cubans go everywhere, help with everything.
So we need them to go, if the government probably need to ask them to come here, you know?
They need to just ask them for the template for this thing, the concept for this thing, because they eradicate all year round. That's one thing. And no, and that is why I am pleased with the plastic ban, because the plastic ban is going to help a lot with the whole stagnant water.
Yes.
But they need to intensify the project by, instead of giving the MPs money or the councillors money to spend for it and then get eradication, which usually doesn't even get done.
Yeah.
Doesn't even get done properly. They need to pay citizens for per pound of plastic bags that they can.
I heard somebody saying that on the news and I thought it was an excellent idea.
Per 10 pound of plastic bag, which you know is a woolly.
Yes.
You know, per 10 pound, pay them some money.
Yes.
Them guys on the street who don't have anything to do, they will go pick up an outer organ and ditch and gully and wash them off and carry them in. And they compress them, so compact them somewhere and put them somewhere. You know, but this can work. It can work.
You're so right. Boy, Dr. Petra Hines, I need to thank you so much. I know that the people on my life, both IG, the IG is off now, but this information is invaluable. We could not have asked for a better discussion on dengue. I hope that We really can nip this in the bud, but just thank you from the bottom of my heart. And guys, if you have not seen her video as yet, it's on my page. And I'm supposed to get her video by WhatsApp by now, but it's on my page. I'm going to post the link again.
It was sent around in the floor email, their staff email.
Right.
And I think Finance sent it around in their staff email too.
Excellent.
So it is going.
It is going around.
A radio person coming from New York saying he has a lot of Jamaicans in his area and he needs to do an interview too. So
excellent.
We're getting somewhere.
We're getting somewhere. I'm very happy. Thank you so much for joining me, my darling. We'll talk off the air. You too. Take care.
Right.
See you.
Yeah.
All right. Bye-bye. Well, guys, there you have it. My good friend, Dr. Petra Hines, who, you know, I'm just very happy that she grabbed this dengue epidemic by the horns, and she's tackling it head on. She against the world, as she says, she's getting a lot of fight from ministry, people in the ministry, but that's what we have to do, because this thing is real. It's serious. It is real. Karine is saying, I live in Ultras and I saw persons come to my house fogging, but too late, always Jamaicans cry. Well, it's better late than never. That's how me see it. You know, education is key. Sit your children down. Talk to them. Let them know why they have to use the repellent. Let them know why they have to wear the long sleeve clothes. Just let them know. So this is what we are facing now. Me kind of glad say me go through it already. So me know me can't go through it again, because I'm telling you that you're in this cycle anyway. This dengue ain't pretty, right? So thank you for joining me as usual. If you have not shared this video as yet, go, as a matter of fact, make me do the same thing now, because I don't think me did share it, because they will lick a piece of phone when they give my son. But if you haven't shared this live video as yet, I'm going to ask you to share it, because this gives you a lot of information about dengue, and we need the information out. Dengue, the information is key, right? I will agree with the minister in saying that we cannot rely just on the ministry, because let me tell you something, and a few of them relatives dying. It's not their children dying. It's not their babies dying. It's our babies dying. Our babies dying. And I'm telling you, all of it is shake. It's, trust me, if you are here and you see what's going on, if you know and you see how heartrending it is. Anyway, guys, we are now at 9:18. I think we had a very good show. We're over an hour. So I want to thank you for joining me. Next week, I think we're going to, the crime stats are in now. So we're going to look at the crime from last year coming into this year. I think that's what we're going to do for next week, Monday morning meds. So I'm going to see how many experts I can get in the time. I don't know who yet, but I'll try to get somebody who can inform you. As usual, apart from this platform, I'm also on Instagram. So if you're not following me on Instagram, it's Kamla_TheRipeMango. I'm also on YouTube. Subscribe to my YouTube channel, Kamla The Ripe Mango. So until next week, blessings, more time. Enjoy your week. Take care.